to my 100 Books a Year Challenge. Today I will talk about my all-time favorite writer, Fyodor Mikhailovich Dostoevsky, and I will tell you why I consider him a prophet. Although he would never think of himself as a prophet, he was one of those mediators that would definitely send to humanity to deliver, warn, and direct us. Hearing this, Fyodor Mikhailovich would probably shrug his shoulders and laugh at my attempts to glorify him. He was one of those people who would, even today, with all his worldwide fame, take public transportation, do his own laundry, and humbly apologize when someone steps on his foot. After a wicked childhood, tormented youth, 10 years of hard labor in Siberia, seizures that left him half dead every time, and a constant hovering above him poverty, Dostoevsky never complained on any of these life experiences that he was exposed to, but strategically used them to shape this global understanding of a human nature. Those experiences not only shaped him as a writer, but in a way opened up his third eye, made him extra sensitive to the things that other people don't notice or don't take seriously. One near-death experience, though, made him a real prophet. The case, with some chilling details, is described in his novel The Idiot. In 1849, all members of, some say harmless, some say not so harmless, circle of Mikhail Petrashevsky, circle of intelligent youth speaking up against Tsarist autocracy, they were arrested and sentenced to death on Semyonovsky Platz of St. Petersburg. Luckily for the world, this was just a bad joke from Tsar Nicholas I to teach the youngsters a lesson. At the very last moment, the execution was cancelled and the circle was sent off to eastern Siberia. Dostoevsky was able to come back to St. Petersburg only after 10 years of hard labor. Those 10 minutes of near-death experience never really left him. The mock execution was super real for those who were standing in front of the firing squad preparing to be shot. And from that moment, Dostoevsky grasped the world from the other dimension. Like a prophet Ezekiel, he made this mystical journey to the other side that shifted his perspective forever. In those 10 minutes, the young man went down to Hades and brought back the knowledge that would make him the best advocate of humanity. But why was he a prophet? First of all, Dostoevsky predicted Russian Revolution, its cause and reason, 50 years before it actually happened, and the destruction of Russia under Soviet terror. He was also aware of the changes that were happening in the Western world, where the cursed million, how he called money, capitalism, were shaping our new nature. The million, a true god of my generation, wrote Dostoevsky, that is a true power of the nobodies over a human. Who has a million, that one is the emperor, the autocrat, since everything is sold and everything is bought. Technological revolution was an exciting event in the middle of the 19th century. People viewed it as a huge step towards the happiness of all human beings. Sometimes it felt like they're so close to make everyone happy. The same kind of idea later the Soviets chased, but Dostoevsky knew better. He never spoke against technological revolution, of course. He fully realized its potential, its significance and importance. But in his novel The Idiot, there is this interesting conversation between the buffoon Lebedev and Prince Myshkin, where Lebedev interprets Star Wormwood from the Book of Revelation as the modern railroads that cover the whole Europe as a net and corrupt the spring of life. Dostoevsky certainly laughs with us at Lebedev's attempts to prophesy. Lebedev today would probably be one of those people who on national television go on spreading QAnon conspiracy theories or Bill Gates conspiracy theories. However, nothing in Dostoevsky's writing is one-dimensional. Lebedev justifies himself and says that it's not the railroads that he means, but the idea of the railroads, its materialistic aspect. We hurry and push and hustle for the good of humanity. The world is becoming too noisy, too commercial, says Lebedev, proclaiming the birth of capitalism. He doesn't believe in wagons bringing bread to humanity, the technology that would save us all. Why? And here's where the writer's voice comes in. Because if founded on no moral principle, these wagons can coldly exclude a considerable portion of humanity from enjoying it. That has been seen more than once. Another thing is, yes, those wagons of bread can reduce poverty, can fight hunger, but did Raskolnikov, for instance, kill the old moneylender just because of empty stomach and the room that reminded of a coffin? You might argue with me that that was the reason, although I think that the idea comes first, the idea of privilege of one human being over the other, or one nation over the other. Killing a pawnbroker, he was making a point that he's not a trembling creature that he dares to kill. Or another example, why didn't life of privilege and comfort and admiration of people and beauty and talent prevent Stavrogin from raping a little girl? And we know, as a matter of fact, that even now, no wealth, no comfort prevents people from committing the most horrible crimes. Dostoevsky here opposes the common belief that technological revolution will save the humanity. Because of that, Dostoevsky got himself into a lifelong war with the most radical popular leftists in Russia in the 19th century, like Nikolai Dobrolyubov, Nikolai Chernyshevsky, Dmitry Pisarev, and Sergei Nechayev. He was a prophet after all, and prophets are supposed to be stoned, aren't they? Dostoevsky remembered very well the vibe of Petrushevsky's circle, the recklessness and radicalism of youth. But after his return from hard labor, he knew the world has changed. The growing movement of nihilists invaded Russia and Europe. Nihilists thought that there's nothing to approve of in the established social order in Russia. They laughed at Dostoevsky's liberalism and called for a new social order, new radical change. If it requires use of force, so be it. Dostoevsky knew that these initially noble, altruistic ideas of social change would become a terror one day. This noble desire, idea to end human suffering, will lead to very tragic consequences. In March 13, 1881, only a month after Dostoevsky's death, the whole Russia witnessed in horror the murder of Tsar Alexander II by the terrorist group Narodnaya Volya, People's Will. Then Dostoevsky started his own battle with nihilism. Notes from the Underground was his first answer to the nihilist ideas. It was supposed to cool down the ideological drive towards this pretty much utopian society. The bitter underground man isolates himself from the society and very often acts irrationally just to prove that, yes, he, untamed, illogical, ridiculous human being, does have the right to exist, and he does exist in this modern world. By doing so, he expresses his freedom and protests against pragmatical, logical nihilists. If Notes from the Underground criticizes nihilism, then Crime and Punishment aims to destroy it. Dostoevsky wrote, "One cannot build happiness on the suffering and death of even one man, even the worst man, if you're a human, of course, not a Napoleon." In killing the pawnbroker, Raskolnikov believes he's performing an act of mercy for humanity. He will become equal to Napoleon, who destroys one useless creature, steps over one body to save millions of others. That way, Raskolnikov establishes his own nihilistic moral boundaries, which say that if there is no God, then there are no moral consequences for actions. Everything is permitted, everything is allowed. And that way, Dostoevsky proclaims the birth of terrorism. Some critics at those times blamed Dostoevsky in bad-mouthing the youth, picturing an unrealistic image of it. But on January 12, 1866, only a few days after publishing Crime and Punishment, a nobleman, 19-year-old law student named Danilov, committed a crime that painfully reminded of the details described in Crime and Punishment. Danilov killed a moneylender and his servant in order to rob their apartment. Landsberg, a brilliant officer, participant of the Russian-Turkish War, killed a moneylender, Vlasov, whom he owed a lot of money. This is the truth Dostoevsky could read in the newspapers, and he used it to create these hyper-realistic characters. But it was with Demons in 1872 where Dostoevsky really poured his wrath over nihilism and all the utopian ideals. Of all his novels, Demons were probably the most prophetic one. A new hero of the radical circle, Sergei Nechayev, was a prototype of Verkhovensky in Demons. He organized a society of national massacre with a prison-like discipline. When a Moscow student Ivanov showed disagreement and decided to leave the circle, Nechayev ordered to kill the rebel. Ivanov was trapped in the park and murdered by four of his comrades. Sounds familiar? This common murder was supposed to create the special bond, pack of blood between the murderers. The police quickly caught them, only Nechayev was lucky enough to escape. He ran abroad. The story is retold in Demons as the story of Shatov, who was killed by Verkhovensky and his circle. In Demons, charismatic Stavrogin and obsessed with him Verkhovensky take action to raise the spirit of fear and confusion all over Russia. they pretty soon turn into absolute violence and terrorism, as did Nechayev's circle. In 1917, revolution in Russia, or rather upheaval, let all those Verkhovenskis, Stavrogins, Lupitins take over Russia and establish a new order of brutal suppression. Remember those wagons of bread that were founded on no moral principle? That were supposed to save the humanity and the nation, right? Instead of crushing it. And so Dostoevsky prophesizes that from the slavery of one kind, the humanity will fall into the trap of the slavery of a different kind, the moral slavery, spiritual slavery, volunteer slavery. Nietzsche's circle believed that the society has to be divided into the group of the leaders like him and the rest, made equal by terror. Verkhovensky reintroduces those ideals in Demons, saying that the most important thing in the new society they are building is that all are slaves and all are equal slaves. Education, creativity, talent will only be available for the chosen few who will rule the rest as a herd. Doesn't it remind you a little bit of Orwell's 1984? I would say Nietzsche's ideas were also reflected in the monologue of the Great Inquisitor from the Brother Karamazov. Dostoevsky's prophetic understanding of the processes that took over the West and Russia, his obsession with intellectual freedom, and his beliefs in Orthodox Christian ideals found full expression in his final novel, The Brother Karamazov. In his last years, Dostoevsky believed that this generation lives in the most indistinct, fatal, transitional moment in history. Before his death, he wrote, "All Russia stands on the final point, hovering over the abyss." All of his works, but especially five of his novels, were meant to warn Russians and the whole world about the upcoming disasters of the 20th century. And despite of his popularity, people didn't really pay attention to his messages until it was too late. Read Dostoevsky and you will know exactly what to be aware of in the future. With this, I wish you sweet readings. Thank you so much for sharing your time with me. Please like and subscribe if you're a Dostoevsky fan or Russian literature history fan. We will talk a lot more about it in the future. See you in my next video. Bye!